Van de Everly Brothers Story vertelt onder meer over het miljoenencontract dat de duo afsloot na het verlaten van het Cadence-label en over de nieuwe serie hits bij Warners.
It was the first million-dollar deal in the history of the record industry. And of course, to be specific, the monkey was a little on our back because we had to prove that we could go on past the Cadence things. So we took, an extra couple of months before we decided on which one to hit the home run with. And Kathy's Kwan was it.
Deel 3 van de Everly Brothers Story, vanavond in Poster, even na 7.
Hello, this is Phil Everly. I'd like you to tune in to the Everly Brothers Story on Tross Radio tonight at 7 p.m.
Dit is Klaas Vaak met de Everly Brothers Story, een Emison-productie in 6 delen. Vanavond het 3e deel.
These are the words of a frontier lad who lost his love when he turned back. Take a message to Mary, but don't tell her where I am. Take a message to Mary, but don't say I'm in a jam. You can tell her I had to see the world, or tell her that my ship set sail. You can say she better not wait for me, but don't tell her I'm in jail. Oh, don't tell her I'm in jail. Take a message to Mary, but don't tell her what I've done. Please don't mention the stagecoach and the shot from a careless gun. You can tell her I had to change my plans and cancel out the wedding day. But please don't mention my lonely cell where I'm gonna find a way until my dying day. Take a message to Mary, but don't tell her all you know. My heart's aching for Mary, Lord knows I miss her so. Just tell her I went to Timbuktu. Tell her I'm searching for gold. You can say she'd better find someone new to cherish and to hold. Oh Lord, this cell is cold.
Take a Message to Mary, de B-kant van Poor Jenny, een dubbelzijdige hit voor de Everlys in het voorjaar van 1959. Het werd geen dramatisch succes, misschien omdat geen van de nummers werd gepromoot als de A-kant, en daarom streden beide kanten voor een hitnotering. Take a Message to Mary deed het beter in Amerika. Het bereikte nummer 16, terwijl Poor Jenny onder meer favoriet was in Engeland. Het nummer bereikte een 14e plaats. Maar de Everlys hadden een betrouwbare succesformule gevonden, de Songs van Bryant, direct gericht op de teenagermarkt, plus de talenten van de jongens zelf. Don, die het gitaarwerk bedacht wat hen zo'n unieke zand gaf, en Phil, die voor dat magische element zorgde, de fantasierijke harmonie in de zang. Don Everly.
In looking back, though, I don't think a lot of those would have ever made it without maybe the sound, you know, that was going on at that time, musically and voice-wise. I think they all, the pieces fit together to make the record, to make it an identity that stood by itself.
It's the whole thing is strange about harmony anyhow. I spent a tremendous amount of time unable to sing harmony because I sang the harmony part. And harmony winds up being something that you have to do instinctively, knowing where you, there's a predictability, but there's not a predictability on how it's going to be slurred or phrased or this, that, and the other. And the more unique a person makes the harmony, the more unique the person makes the lead, the more unique and everything becomes. You know, it all kind of works together. And I tried very hard to do it, and I had to memorize the parts and couldn't always stay on it, you know. And then one day. Just, I couldn't do it in the morning when it was rehearsal, and that afternoon they came back, and I could do it from then on. And I could do it any time, you know, and it didn't matter if it was brand new or what, you know. I always figured if somebody slapped me in the back of the head from somewhere, you know, because it wasn't anything I did consciously.
Phil. Tegen het eind van 1959 hadden de jongens zich gevestigd als een onbetwistbaar succes. Ze hadden 7 hits op hun naam staan en een verbazingwekkend brede aantrekkingskracht. Don Everly.
The Everly Brothers was 2 guys. And this had a lot to do with it, because Elvis Presley was the king of rock. But remember that the audience was teenage girls. We had more guy fans than Elvis did. Back then, it was all right to like the Everly Brothers, but Elvis, you know, guys didn't go dingy over Elvis back then. In fact, if anything, they resented him. But the Everly Brothers, they didn't resent, didn't have that physical-looking threat, that menacing threat that Elvis did. And the Everly Brothers was allowed to appeal to other people other than just teenage girls.
Inmiddels waren de jongens in Nashville lid geworden van de zogenaamde Great American Temple of Country Music, de Grand Ole Opry, en hadden daar ook voor wat opschudding gezorgd. Phil Everly.
We did things like, we had the first drum on the Grand Ole Opry stage, a snare drum, that's all we got on. We were the first ones not to dress on the Grand Ole Opry stage. We wore suits, which was new, and that came and went. In fact, everybody's back in costumes now, aren't they?
Nashville en de invloeden van Nashville hadden de Everly Brothers gevoed tijdens het bepalen en bevestigen van hun oorspronkelijke muzikale afkomst. Nu deden Don en Phil wat terug door te laten zien dat de Amerikaanse countrymuziek makkelijk kon worden geïntegreerd met de Amerikaanse pop en rock and roll. Dat gold trouwens ook voor de rest van de wereld. Wat zij bereikt hadden was enorm. Zij zijn hoofdzakelijk verantwoordelijk voor de country rock explosie die jaren later plaats zou vinden. De manier van brengen van de Everlys was niet alleen de oorzaak. De liedjes van Boudreau en Felice Bryant waren hier ook debat aan. Heeft iemand zich ooit afgevraagd waar ze die belachelijke namen vandaan haalden?
My name, Boudreau, is a French name. And my father named me after a dear friend that he had met in the First World War. His name was Boudreau. And he named me after him.
My name was Matilda Genevieve Scaduto. Boudreau, when we first met, he introduced himself, and I introduced myself as Matilda Scaduto. He says, we've got to do something about that Matilda. So I says, well, what suits you? He says, well, you look jolly. How about Felice? I said, great. About 5 days later, he says, we've got to do something about Scaduto. I says, what suits you? He says, Bryant. I says, great. So Boudreau titled me.
Maar gegeven het succes van de Everly Brothers, waren ze nou niet speciaal met hen in gedachten gaan schrijven?
Well, yes. The answer to that is a simple yes, because for quite a period of time there, we wrote song after song after song, each of which was tailored directly for the Everlys, for the harmony sort of thing that they did. And when the session was coming up, we would show them maybe 8 or 10 songs that we had written specifically for them. Out of those songs, they usually took one or two. They were writing all the time, and they always brought their own songs in. And Archie and the boys got together, along with Wesley, and listened to all the material. And for the first 5 or 6 releases, we happened to have songs that they and Archie liked better than the ones that they'd written. Then they came up with some that everybody liked better than whatever we might have submitted at that particular time.
Never felt like this until I kissed ya. How did I exist until I kissed ya? Never had you on my mind. Now you're there all the time. Never knew what I missed till I kissed ya. Uh-huh, I kissed ya. Oh yeah, things have really changed since I kissed ya. Uh-huh, my life's not the same now that I kissed ya. Oh yeah, you got a will about ya. Now I can't live without ya. Never knew what I missed till I kissed ya. I kissed ya. Oh yeah. You don't realize what you do to me. And I didn't realize what a kiss could be. You got a will about ya. Now I can't live without ya. Never knew what I missed till I kissed ya. I kissed ya. Oh yeah. You don't realize what you do to me. And I didn't realize what a kiss could be. You got a will about ya. Now I can't live without ya. Never knew what I missed till I kissed ya. I kissed ya. Oh yeah, I kissed ya. Uh-huh, I kissed ya. Oh yeah.
Till I Kissed You, de 7e hit voor de Everlys, werd inderdaad door Don zelf geschreven. En hun laatste single voor Cadence was ook niet van de Bryans. Het was in ieder geval de laatste, omdat onder de rustige oppervlakte van het fantastische succes van de Everly Brothers zich enkele gevaarlijke rotsen lieten zien.
In the background there was haranguing. And it wasn't on our side, it was over in the business end and the publishing end of the things that were manipulating the Everly Brothers. That hurt their feelings.
Chet Atkins, die vanaf het begin bevriend was geweest met de Everlys, had ook de nieuwe moeilijkheden in de gaten gekregen. Hij had op alle sessies gespeeld waar de grote hits waren uitgekomen.
At first they went very well. They were fun to do. I was on guitar usually, and Floyd Kramer on piano, and Bob Moore on bass, Buddy Harmon on drums. And later on, we started using Hank Garland on guitar some. But it was fun for a while, and then after all the tremendous success they had, I think there got to be a lot of jealousy between Archie Blyer, the producer, and Wesley Rose, the publisher. Archie wouldn't want to do Wesley's songs every time, but because he brought the act to Archie, well, he figures they should do all A. Cuff Rose songs. So it was no fun to work anymore because they weren't getting along, and this was infectious to the musicians, and we got inhibited, and it was hard to play with all the fussing and quarreling that was going on, so it wasn't fun after a while.
Misschien verklaart dit gekibbel op de achtergrond waarom de Everlys tijdens een Cadence-periode maar 2 LP's hebben gemaakt. the director van Cadence, Archie Blyer.
The LPs were not too successful. However, it's interesting, I still get mail in regard to the old Cadence records. And one of the things about which people write fairly consistently is an LP that was called Songs Our Daddy Taught Us, which was an LP of practically folk songs. I would say that's the strongest mail puller today.
Songs Our Daddy Taught Us. Yeah. That album title tells it all. These are songs for the 99% of the ones that my father had been singing and I'd known all my life. I knew we were leaving Cadence, and I wanted the last album to be something musically that I loved, but I didn't want them to have all possible singles, which they would have kept releasing and interfered with our career. So I suggested Songs Our Daddy Taught Us, and everything went for it, so we did it. It was easy to do. Songs like Lightning Express and Kentucky. It's just a good collection of country songs done in a very, very austere manner.
Phil Efferly.
Well, that was really a kind of a compromise situation. It's the last album we did for Cadence, but it was something that we wanted to do, and we knew a lot of the songs. Some of the songs we had learned, you know, later on from But the majority of them were that, were all those old tunes that we'd done with Dad, you know, and the family. We cut that with Lightning Chance and Donald, and that was the only two instruments on it. In those days, you did it fast, you know, we must have cut it in 3 days, 4 days. That used to be the way we did everything, you know, it was all one big, it was like getting ready for the big fight, you know, when you went into a session.
Deck of cards, I lay my money down, lay my money down, lay my money down. I had not been in Washington many more weeks than three, till I fell in love with a pretty little girl. She fell in love with me, fell in love with me, fell in love with me. She took me in her parlor, she cooled me with a fan, she whispered low in her mama's ear, I love that gambling man, love that gambling man, love that gambling man. So, to leave your dear old mother and with a gambler go, with a gambler go, with a gambler go. I've gambled down in Washington, I've gambled down in Spain, I'm going down in Georgia to gamble my last game, gamble my last game, gamble my last game. Mother, oh dear mother, you know I love you well, but the love I have for the gambling man, no human tongue can tell, no human tongue can tell.
Rovin Gambler. De andere Cadence LP was een verzameling van de beroemde hitsingles en de B-kanten en een handvol andere nummers. Beide Cadence LP's met hun verschillende combinaties en uitgebracht onder diverse titels zijn een paar maal gereleased. Zowel op Cadence en Barnaby in Amerika als op CBS, Janus en Barnaby in Europa. De laatste single die Don en Phil opnamen voor Cadence begin 1960 werd ironisch genoeg een vaste favoriet voor drie mensen die nu de Everly Brothers story verlaten. Boudelot and Felice Bryant and Archie Blyer.
One of the interesting records that the boys made, which was a bit out of the norm for them, was a beautiful ballad called Let It Be Me. And their performance was excellent. There's a strange thing happens when a performer feels a song strongly to the point that it becomes a part of him. And I think that happened with Let It Be Me. And therefore it became a hit. Not a million copy hit, but we must have done at least 750,000 on it.
Let It Be Me, that was a French melody. I've forgotten who wrote it, but somebody in France wrote the melody, and I believe that Archie Blyer got somebody to write, either commissioned the lyrics over here or found the song after it had been over here and somebody had written an English lyric to it. But that's a beauty. I think that's one of the best ones they ever did.
I bless the day I found you. I want to stay around you, and so I beg you, let it be me. heaven from one if you must cling to someone now and forever. Let it be me. Each time we meet, love, I find
Phil Effley.
1960 was the turning point in a lot of things. In 1960, as we'd been hot for 3 years, you know, we'd had a very long run. And that was actually a very interesting year. That's part of the most interesting year.
1960 betekende inderdaad een belangrijk jaar voor de Effleys. Don en Phil veranderden van label in het voorjaar. Ze kwamen bij Warner Brothers onder contract. Een contract met een waarde van $1 miljoen. Een contract zonder precedenten. Het was het eerste platencontract met 6 nullen. De huidige directeur van Warner, die in 1961 bij bedrijf in dienst trad, zal directe contacten met de Effleys onderhouden. Joe Smith.
The contract was in fact a $1 million commitment. It predated my own time at Warner Brothers, but at the time the deal was made, I was a disc jockey in Boston and New York, and was very conscious of it because it was a desperation contract made by Warner Brothers Records. The company had opened with great fanfare a couple of years previous to that, and had lost an enormous amount of money by attempting to operate as a major record company initially and having not much of an artist roster of any note. And they were faced with a situation of continuing to develop Hawaiian albums and string albums and piano albums, which are sometimes the backbone of a catalog, but what they needed was some hit material. And a fellow named Jim Conkling, who was president of Warner Brothers Records at that time, made the deal with Wesley Rose, who was the grand seigneur of the Everly Brothers, and they started with a great rush with an enormous record, a number one hit of that year.
Wesley Rose.
Well, I negotiated the contract with Warner Brothers. We had decided, well, actually, the two boys had decided they no longer wanted to be on Cadence about a year before the contract was over. And I had transferred this information on to Archie Blyer. So it wasn't a thing of all of a sudden deciding to leave. It was sort of a personality conflict, and it just wouldn't have worked any longer. So I started working to negotiate a contract. And at that particular time, Warner Brothers was just starting over here. They had been out maybe a year or two. And I talked to Jim Conkling, president of Warner Brothers. So we had gotten in and started to negotiate a deal. Well, the negotiations were working fine right up until the last day before the announcement. And at that time, Jim Conkling and I had a misunderstanding, so I told him the deal was off. Well, there was a fellow called Herman Starr, who was head of Warner Brothers Publishing, who was head of all the Warner Brothers at the time. And he called me up and said, Wes, look, we need the Everly Brothers bad, otherwise we may just close the label. The label is very unsuccessful. And he says, I'll give you even more than you're asking. I said, I don't want any more than I'm asking. I want exactly what we talked about. So we closed the deal out, and it was the first $1 million deal in the history of the record industry. And of course, to be specific, the monkey was a little on our back because we had to prove that we could go on past the Cadence things. So we took, an extra couple of months before we decided on which one to hit the home run with. And Kathy's Clown was it. And when Kathy's Clown was released here, it was also simultaneous released in England. And we were in London at the time when Warner Brothers label started. And needless to say, we were really tickled and happy because it went to number one in 3 days. And I think Kathy's Clown was the first simultaneous hit just about all over the world for them.
Everly.
I wrote about an old high school girlfriend of mine. My father once said a line. He said once that when he was a kid, he had a girlfriend called Mary. And he'd come walking home from school, and the kids would tease him. And they would say, Mary had a little like, you know. And to me, I always thought that was funny. It was kind of a funny story in my family. But I knew that if we didn't get a hit the first time out on Warner Brothers, that everyone would say, it was Archie Blyer that was the secret. It was Archie Blyer. And I was bound and determined that wasn't going to happen. We waited for that one for a long while. And everything had to be right, and it was right. It was a very good turn of events for us, actually.
Phil Everly.
Donald called me. He lived that time, lived across the street, you know, from the Nashville house, and he called me, and he had written, Don't Want You to Love It, the chorus of it, and he had a melody on thing, and I just kind of came over and finished it off real fast. It sounded like a hit to me from the first, you know, and I wrote the verses, and that's all. We took it in and cut it maybe in 2 days, and I knew it was a hit. We just knew it, you know, you could feel it.
Don't want your love.
niet mislukken. Een onmiddellijk nummer 1 succes in elk land waar de plaat uitkwam. Iedereen was blij. Warner Brothers hadden een superhit. De Everly Brothers hadden de problemen met Cadence achter zich gelaten. En over de hele wereld waren ze de lievelingen van media en publiek.
Their music was the easiest to play. It found instant audience. There was nothing very subtle about it. And it was melodic. And they sang well.
Joe Smith, toen nog discjockey bij een radiostation aan de Amerikaanse oostkust.
I found that as I played records by Little Richard, the upper demographics, the upper level of age groups in the audience resented it. They couldn't stand Little Richard. They couldn't stand some of the records we played. But the Everly Brothers never offended anybody. They were easy to play. They were instant on the air. And I felt that they had touched a chord with young people, well, sub-teen young people especially, with their music and their songs and their simplicity. And they were terribly important to me. As a part, as I say, the half a dozen artists who were most influential, whose records, if you could get them on early, got your listeners very devoted to you. And so they were very important at that period.
Basically, my interest in the Everly Brothers started when I was about 11.
So far back.
No, is it that far back? Well, 11, 12, 13. And I've never found anybody that particularly took their place. That doesn't mean to say I don't like anybody else. But I can't imagine what it would have been like without the Everly Brothers, because there's nobody I liked as much to fit into that gap that would have been created if they weren't there. You know, and I can remember sitting at home and all the windows wide open so that I could mind everybody's stereo going full blast. And that's what I used to do. I used to come home and listen to the Everly Brothers.
Mm. There's never anybody else. You know, you can't remember a time when you didn't like them.
Sue and Laura from the Internationale Fanclub van de Everly Brothers. 1960 was het jaar waarin de broers het toppunt van hun roem bereikten. En Kathy's Clown was maar de eerste van een hele serie hits voor Warner. Phil Everly.
When we did Lucille, we had every guitar player in Nashville. We had 8 playing at one time, the same riff instead of multiple recording, you know, like they do now. It was 8 guys playing, you know that thing. And it was such a big guitar sound. I think that's probably the main reason that song was able to come back that fast, because it hadn't been that long since it had been a hit.
Lucille kwam uit in september 1960, dat het eigenlijk de B-kant zullen zijn van wat opnieuw een dubbelzijdige hit zou worden. Met weer beide titels strijdend voor de hoogste plaats op de hitparade. De A-kant was So Sad, een Don Everly-compositie.
I just wrote that one morning. I write songs, sometimes out of necessity. Very seldom, no. I write what I feel. I'd have to be inspired.
We used to have good times together. But now I feel them slip away.
So Sad van Don Everly. Inmiddels bracht Cadence in een concurrerende positie een nummer van Phil Everly uit. En hoewel het toen een archiefnummer was, is het sindsdien een belangrijke Everly classic geworden. Het loopt tegen het eind van 1960 en Cadence tracht zo lang mogelijk mee te profiteren van het succes van het duo. Like Strangers komt uit en haalt een magere notering in de top 100. Het werd in januari 1961 weggeveegd door een andere dubbelzijdige bonushit.
Nothing seems to be
Walk Right Back, geschreven door Sonny Curtis van de Crickets, bereikt een zevende plaats in Amerika en behoudt in Engeland de nummer 1 notering voor 3 weken. De B-kant, die ook de diverse hitparades haalde, werd geschreven door John D. Loudermilk en was, zoals meer nummers in die tijd, een stijlvolle maar tragische liefde-dood-classic. Phil Everly.
It was such a temptation that we went ahead and did it. Well, I'm still scared of flying. I don't know about everybody else. And that's really what the song deals with. It's got that old-time religion kind of attitude about the death. But, you know, I think when it comes down to death, we all get old-time religion. So, you know, I don't feel that it's too naive. It's too depressing. Just to kind of a downer, you know. Although we never performed the song live. Never. I've seen it done by people in clubs and everything. I'm surprised how well it comes off. It is also the most requested song that we never did.
On a weekend pass, I wouldn't have had time to get home and marry that baby of mine. So I went to the chaplain and he authorized me to send for my ebony eyes. My ebony eyes was coming to me from out of the skies on flight 1203. In an hour or two, I would whisper I do to my beautiful ebony eyes.
The plane was way overdue, so I went inside to the airline's desk and I said, "Sir, I wonder why 1203 is so late." He said, "Oh, they probably took off late. They may have run into some turbulent weather and had to alter their course." I went back outside and I waited at the gate and I watched the beacon light from the control tower as it whipped through the dark ebony skies as if it were searching for... And then came the announcement over the loudspeaker. Those having relatives or friends on flight number 1203, please report to the chapel across the street at once.
Then I felt a burning break deep inside, and I knew the heavenly, ebony skies had taken my life's most wonderful prize.
Rond 1961 hadden Don en Phil Nashville verlaten en ze waren naar Hollywood vertrokken. En inderdaad, er werd een bijna onvermijdelijke, amusante verhouding aangegaan met de filmindustrie. Gearrangeerd door hun manager Wesley Rose.
I had negotiated a motion picture deal for the boys. So I had put Don and Phil in Warner Brothers acting class out there. I wanted to make sure they had at least the fundamentals of acting. And the picture we had would have been a very big picture.
Phil en Don hebben echter een andere mening over deze escapade.
When we came to Warner's, we also went into their acting school and we didn't do a screen test. Oh, that's funny. Wesley has had an attitude about acting that I'm sure it was as much as we all knew about acting out of Nashville, Tennessee. But you either have it or you don't have it.
I never wanted to be in the movies. Because you're great in a recording studio doesn't make you a movie actor. That's like being a doctor saying, "Oh, God, I'm really a great doctor. I'm going to go be a lawyer now." I hear so many bad actors singing. I mean, good actors that can't sing. Why should it, because I can sing, make me a good actor?
They've somehow managed to get a screen test, Wesley did, through an agency, and it cost him a lot of money, which at that time it was like $25,000, which was a lot of money in those days. And they strapped guns on Don and I, and Donald was dressed as Black Bart, and I was the Kind Charlie, you know, in brown. I looked like the clean cut, and he looked like Lash LaRue. Anyway, they had us in a room, a cabin, I mean a real cabin, and it was the director from Bonanza, I think, or Wagon Train, somebody like that. When things are going bad on a set, it gets real quiet. And things got so quiet there that you could hear everything, you know, like squeaking of shoes, and which reminds me of another story. The first screen test that I took, because you know, I took one separately from Donald, because he had the flu. And I went down and squeaked my way through a screen test. But we were sitting in a cabin, and we were, you know the song, Take a Message to Mary, Lisa? I'm sitting in the cabin, and they switched it around so that Donald comes by the cabin door, and he's supposed to be a stranger, you know, and he comes by the window, and I'm sitting in the cabin, and I'm saying, these are the words of a frontier lad, lost his love when he went bad. Then we sing, take a message to Mary together, and we, you know, he says, howdy, stranger, and I say, howdy, stranger. We just sung this duet together, you know, him standing outside my window, and he asks me a bunch of things, and this flubs around for, I don't know, 5 or 10 times, you know, about an 11th take, and Donald's last line is, well, I'll be seeing you. And I said, not in the movies.
These are the words of a frontier lad who lost his love when he turned bad. Take a message to Mary, but don't tell her where I am. Take a message to Mary, but don't say I'm in a jam. You can tell her I had to see the world, or tell her that my ship set sail. You can say she better not wait for me, but don't tell her I'm in jail. Oh, don't tell her I'm in jail.
That's the way it worked out. In fact, I remember the line, Donald couldn't get a line. And just, it got so stiff and quiet, you know, that everything became very tense. And it was absurd. Donald had a line he couldn't remember. And the line is, and bravely dare the danger that nature shrinks from. Good line, huh? How's that? You like that one? And they had finally wound up writing it down on the table, on the piece of paper, and they're shooting a close-up of Donald. And Donald comes to that line, Donald, and I remember a line Donald says, and he says, bravely dare the danger, just read it, you know. And they destroyed the film, they said, because Wesley tried to buy it. Here's a couple of years ago, he said, they destroyed it. I said, thank you.
Met Little Hollywood Girl, een zeer toepasselijk nummer dat pas werd uitgebracht, besluiten we deel 3 van de Everly Brothers story. Het werd onlangs ontdekt in de archieven van Warner Brothers. De Everly Brothers story werd in Londen geproduceerd door Emison. Luister volgende week naar deel 4 van de serie. Techniek vanavond Gert de Bruin en Jacques Hollemans. Poster is een trotsprogramma van Tom Mulder.
Each day you think a producer will give you your star. But when go to audition, you never get the part. You're only one of a million girls in a town without a heart. Little Hollywood girl, better call in a day. Little Hollywood girl, put your makeup. Dazzled by, don't shine your name. You know your chances are slimmer now, and you're sorry you came. You wish that you could go home again. You no longer care for fame, little Hollywood girl. Never felt like this until I kissed ya. How did I exist until I kissed ya? Never had you on my mind. Now you're there all the time. Never knew what I missed until I kissed ya. I kissed ya. Oh yeah. Things have really changed since I kissed ya. My life's not the same now that I kissed ya. Oh yeah. You got a way about ya. Now I can't live without ya. Never knew what I missed until I kissed ya. I kissed ya. Oh yeah. You don't realize what you do to me, and I didn't realize what a kiss could be. You got a way about you. Now I can't live without you. Never knew what I missed until I kissed you. I kissed you. Oh yeah, you don't realize what you do to me, and I didn't realize what a kiss could be. You got a way about you. Now I can't live without you. Never knew what I missed until I kissed you. I kissed you. Oh yeah, I kissed ya. I kissed ya. Oh yeah.
Elf over 1 en dat is erin van de Everly Brothers. Van een LP en die hit The Very Best of the Everly Brothers. De Trosparade LP voor deze week. Dit is Klaas Staak met de Everly Brothers Story. Een Emison-productie in 6 delen. Vanavond het 4e deel.
Kathy's Clown, we made an effort at Warner Brothers to be a little more innovative, you know. And, of course, we ran into the split with Wesley Rose, which put us out of touch totally with Boudlow and Boudlow's songs. and we couldn't get them at the time, so we had to find new material. That's when we did Temptation. Well, we had done Temptation when we were still with Wesley, but we'd also done the John D. Loudermilk song, Ebony Eyes, and Wesley wanted that out, and we wanted Temptation out, and that's where we wound up leaving Wesley. And so the next album we did had to have the standardy kind of songs. That's when we put out Temptation.
Met Temptation en de stem van Phil Effely beginnen we deel 4 van de Effely Brothers story, waarin blijkt dat de broers zich toch in een platenstudio meer thuis voelden dan in de filmstudio. Temptation bewees opnieuw een hit te zijn, vooral in Europa en bijvoorbeeld in Engeland, waar de plaat 2 weken op nummer 1 bleef.
So sick. I've been living in the water all my life. It's the one where I ain't sick. I ain't sick. I ain't sick. I ain't sick. Groundhog, groundhog, what makes your back so brown? I've been living in the ground all my life. It's the one where I'm around. I'm around. I'm around. I'm around. Jaybird, what makes you fly so high? I've been eating these acorns all my life. It's the one where I don't die, I don't die, I don't die, I don't die.
Muskrat, relatief gezien een middelmatige single, werd uitgebracht in de herfst van 1961. De Effelys hadden er een probleem bij gekregen, het vinden van het juiste nieuwe materiaal. Omdat ze naar Californië waren verhuisd, waren hun banden met Nashville verslechterd, mede door het vertrek van Wesley Rose, en ze begonnen nu langzamerhand de Bryans te missen als bron voor nieuwe liedjes. Vooral bij het opnemen van albums werd dit problematisch, en daarom werd er besloten, en dat kwam helemaal niet als verrassing, dat alle beroemde hits opnieuw werden opgenomen, dit keer voor Warners.
Well, we were trying to figure out what to cut, and we didn't have songs again. It was a problem of songs. And Lou Adler, oddly enough, is the one that said, why don't you cut a hits album? And they put together a hits album, and that was the Golden Hits of the Everly Brothers, and that's how that came about. That led to the eventually recutting, you know.
Johnny is a joker. What a dog. Johnny is a joker that's trying to steal my baby. He's a bird dog.
Don Effely.
I like the originals best. Warners wouldn't like me to say that, but that's true. If you ever do anything for the first time, it's never quite the same after, is it?
Never felt like this until I kissed ya. How did I exist until I kissed ya? Never had you on my mind. Now you're there all the time. Never knew what I missed until I kissed ya. I kissed ya. Oh yeah.
Phil Effely.
I don't have the problems about old stuff that everybody does, because I have a basic theory that it's like I'm very proud of the lasting ability of the music. I'm very proud of the influence that we've had. And it's probably more apparent to me than it would be to the general public, but I can spot it and it makes me feel prideful. So I never was concerned with the fact that we're doing old shtock, because if our stuff was such old stuff, it wouldn't have been emulated so much, you know. So I just kind of enjoyed. Plus, I had the added advantage, and of all the times we sang the songs, I sing the harmony. And when you sing the harmony, you have to listen to the lead, so every time's different.
Charms, whenever I want you, all I have to do is dream. Dream, dream, dream when I feel blue in the night and I need you to hold me tight. Whenever I want you, all I have to do is dream.
Maar hoe verschillend de meningen van Don en Phil ook waren, er was één groep mensen zeer blij met de nieuwe opname, die tussen de haakjes in Nashville werden gemaakt. De mensen bij Warners, directeur Joe Smith.
We tried to make a deal to buy the original masters from Cadence Records. But at the time, Andy Williams was at CBS Records. And Andy wanted CBS, he was a major recording artist at that point, one of CBS's biggest artists. And they were renegotiating his deal, and he said to CBS, look, buy that Cadence catalog because I don't want those albums mine. Archie Blyer had recorded Andy Williams as well as the Everlys. And so CBS had to buy it all. They didn't want to buy the Everlys records, but they had to buy it all. So I had intended putting out all those other records after the re-recording restrictions faded. You know, you're not supposed to re-record the same song for 5 years and so forth. So we just got them in the studio and re-recorded it again. And that album, we'd already had the best of the Everly Brothers. That was only a compilation of the Warner Brothers hits. So now we took the re-recording of Wake Up Little Susie and so forth, and we made the very best of. And we had a most successful album.
I'm gonna cry. Bye bye, love. Bye bye, sweet caress. Hello, emptiness. I feel like I could die.
De nieuwe opnames zijn nu verschillende keren uitgebracht op diverse verzamel-LP's. Gedurende de jaren 60, toen ze bij Warner Brothers onder contract stonden, produceerden de Everly Brothers niet minder dan 17 LP's. Ze variëren nogal en laten zowel de zwakke als de sterke punten van Don en Phil zien.
I'm Phil, Everly that is. We've got a new album and we are introducing it to you in this souvenir sampler. We've added a few thoughts and notes to tell you why we selected the songs that follow. I guess the reason we selected Bully of the Town was that it has been around for a long, long time and held many memories for us.
Not only that, the musicians kind of liked fooling around with the song, and we think they did a very good job.
I think every artist has done a memory tune sometime with just a slight twist to it. The next tune received this treatment from us. It usually takes years for a song to become a standard, but we think this next song reached that status the day it was first released. We only wish that we were the first to record The Wayward Wind. I picked my gal Sal.
Philip, we picked my gal Sal because...
This is Jim Conkling, and I picked this song for the boys.
Well, I guess next time we'll read the fine print.
They call her frivolous Sal, a peculiar sort of a gal with a heart that was mellow and all.
Our father taught us many songs, but here's one of Mother's favorites. Do you remember the grandfather's clock?
Well, Donald, Mother taught us the words, but the arrangement, that's something else.
9 years without slumbering, tick-tock, tick-tock, is life's seconds numbering. Tick-tock, tick-tock, it stopped short.
Jimmy McHugh's catalog of song hits is too heavy for both of us to carry.
Philip, just tell him we picked Don't Blame Me because we liked it.
I just thought I would make it more appealing.
My brother and I will now sing Don't Blame Me. Hi Lily is one of the simplest, most beautiful songs we can think of, and we think it is one of the all-time favorites of everyone.
Well, Donald, it's one of our favorites.
A song.
Now Is the Hour, a favorite farewell song from the war days, also has many memories for us.
We first heard it several years ago in Australia. It's a Maori song that the Maori natives sing to all travelers.
Now.
This tune is a sort of thank you tune that well may be our theme song in years to come, for we'll always have you to remember.
May I add a line? When I grow too old to dream, we'll still have you in our hearts.
From both of us, thank you for the past and the present and also our future.
When I grow too old to dream,
I guess like thousands of others, we're night people. We watch the late movies on TV.
Especially the musicals. That's where we discovered love is where you find it.
Only we've done it a little different.
zeldzame sampler die Don en Phil uitbrachten om hun Both Sides of an Evening LP te promoten. Een succesvol album waarmee werd geprobeerd zowel de raver als de meer romantische fans gelijktijdig te bereiken. Terwijl de zogenaamde partyalbums goed aansloegen, waren er wat vreemde nummers bij. Een van die gevallen was Christmas with the Everly Brothers, een kerst-LP waar zelfs de fanclub niet helemaal van overtuigd is.
Oh, that's nice. That was lovely. That really was. Wasn't it?
Did you say so?
Didn't you like
no,
it?
I don't care for it.
It's just, oh, I thought it was nice.
Doesn't seem to be them somehow.
Well, there's so many of the carol things that come out from the various pop groups, various people. But this one, it seemed to be sort of so straightforward, so simple. All you had was the organ and the Boys Town, the choir, in the background. And there was no gimmicks with it or anything.
No, there wasn't.
And I thought it was really nice. Actually, I thought the idea behind it was very good. As far as I'm aware, the profit from that was to go to the Boys Town in Nebraska. And I thought it was nice. And I think Phil's rendition of Oh Little Town of Bethlehem is superb.
Oh, little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie.
I'll do my crying in the rain.
I'll do my crying in the rain.
Het is nu 1962. Het nieuwe jaar wordt door de Everly Brothers begonnen met een nieuwe hit, Crying in the Rain. De plaat bereikte in de Amerikaanse top 100 een zesde en in de Engelse top 20 een vijfde plaats. Zoals bekend zijn er geen statistische gegevens van Nederlandse hitparades van voor 1965. Hier is Joe Smith.
I'm Joe Smith. I was at Warner Brothers Records from October 1961 right through the final breakup of the Everly Brothers. At the time I joined Warner's, I was head of national promotion and moved into A&R and got very deeply involved with Philip and Donald in terms of the kind of records they made and the producers they worked with. Their vocal sound was impeccable. Their harmonies were great. And when I got there in October of 1961, one of our first records was Crying in the Rain, and Warner Brothers Records was not one of your great hit factories at the time, so to have a record that sounded like a hit was a major thing for us. And I got our very small promotional crew together and I said, we got to try to do something with this record. And I had Phil and Don come into the office and make some phone calls to disc jockeys around the country. We told our distributors it was a do or die record for us, which in fact it might have been. Had that record not happened, it would have been another blow for Warner's, and the parent company, the picture company, was contemplating closing down the record division anyhow. But in winter of 1962, the record started to come alive and was a hit, a top 10 hit in the States. And then we had a pretty good run for a year and a half with the Everly Brothers, with records of varying position on the charts, but they were successful, and they were still an important factor. And as music was gradually changing in the 60s, they were not changing along with it too much in terms of the songs they were doing. Then we looked for other avenues. David Gates I got in to do some arrangements. Jimmy Webb we tried to get involved with the Everlys, but it appeared we were in trouble because the music was changing. And at that point, they'd come back from a tour of England in the early 60s and told me about this group they had seen. And it was funny, Donald Everly was wearing a leather jacket, had a motorcycle outside, had what was, by our standards, long hair at that time. He said, well, these guys look funny. He says, they got long hair and they dress funny, he said. And of course, he was referring to the Beatles, but I looked at Everly. I said, they look funny? What are you talking about?
We come.
Confessions, dat in het midden van 1962 een negende plaats bereikte in de Amerikaanse hitparade. Het nummer had tevens de dubieuze eer het laatste Amerikaanse top 10 succes voor de broers te zijn. En zo rond die tijd waren er nog andere zaken die hun leven zouden veranderen. Waaronder Uncle Sam zelf, Don Everly.
And everyone says, well, what happened to the Everly Brothers then? Well, you didn't hear them on the charts. Well, the Everly Brothers wound up in the Marine Corps.
Phil.
We got drafted, you know, we were going to be drafted. And Donald is going through a divorce, so he had to join up too, you know. And so we went into the Marines, and I, to this day, still blame Donald's choice. Because Donald said that they had the best-looking uniforms. And I said, Donald, that's a rough outfit. And we'd had an uncle in the Marines, so we kind of really wanted to do it for that reason. And we went into there, and that was an experience and a half. We had got the same treatment as everybody else, and they shaved our heads, just like, you know, and they gave us, put us through it, just like they did everybody else.
It takes you out of what you're doing. I mean, it'll change you. I'll give anybody, even the 6 months in the Marine Corps that we spent, will change you. You come back a little bit different. Saved my life in the long run, because about that time we got involved with this terrible, terrible doctor in New York City. He's one of these Dr. Feelgood, you know. They got this thing where they can make everything all right. But I was in such good condition from the Marine Corps. Thank God that it didn't kill me.
No one can make my sunshine smile. She goes out 7 nights a week. But she's unhappy all the while. Each night a different guy does his very best to try. But no one can make my sunshine smile. My sunshine used to smile for me. But then she traded me for style. Now she's got Romeos who buy her fancy clothes. But no one can make my sunshine smile. Once her smile could light up the room and make the sun look dim. She said goodbye to me. She hasn't smiled for quite a while. I was just her little clown. But since I'm not around, well, no one can make my sunshine smile.
In mei 1962 werden de jongens eervol ontslagen uit militaire dienst. Beiden hadden gediend bij het 196e peloton van het 8e bataljon 105 van de Amerikaanse marine. Phil als soldaat eerste klas, Don als sergeant. Tegen het eind van 1962 werd Don't Ask Me To Be Friends als single uitgebracht. Maar het was de B-kant die de hitparade haalde. Het nummer haalde een negende plaats in Engeland. In de Verenigde Staten zelf kwam de plaat niet hoger dan een 48e plaats. Het betekende een plotselinge teruggang in populariteit voor de Everly Brothers. Het geluk zat er niet langer mee en de vier volgende platen die uitkwamen haalden de top 100 helemaal niet meer. En terwijl Don en Phil topartiesten waren, ontdekten zij ten koste van zichzelf dat een hit pas een hit is als je een goed nummer opneemt. En dat was het grote probleem. Het leek alsof ze het juiste materiaal niet meer konden vinden. En verder nam de concurrentie natuurlijk grotere vormen aan. In 1962 en 1963 overspoelde het zilveren geluid van de surf de Amerikaanse hitlijsten met de Beach Boys in de voorhoede. Terwijl het zich muzikaal ontplooiende zonnige Californië natuurlijk ook een aardig steentje bijdroeg. Maar zelfs de Amerikaanse muziekbusiness was zich niet bewust van het feit dat een enorme kracht iedereen opzij zou duwen. In 1963 waren er vier knapen uit Liverpool in Engeland bezig iedereen weg te blazen met een aantal internationale nummer 1 hits en een nummer 1 LP. Vreemd genoeg waren Don en Phil net bezig aan een Engelse tournee in die dagen. Don Everly.
Yeah, because when I arrived at the airport, I remember the press being there and having been to England quite a few times, all through the 50s and everything. And the Everly Brothers were the number one vocal group that year, I'm sure in 63 even. That was the year maybe the Beatles became the number one vocal group. And the press, all they wanted to know was what I thought of the Beatles. What do you think of the Beatles? What do you think of the Beatles? I hadn't really heard anything yet, you know. Well, we came back over to the States, and then, this is really strange, we used to go on tour, and all the American acts were now combing their hair forward, you know, and giving up the greasy stuff, and speaking with these strange kind of accents they tried to, you know, sound like they were from England. I was so strange that the music changes, that the look is the most drastic thing you can point to. The Beatles, when they first started out, I mean, musically, that didn't impress me that much. It wasn't too much later that I really ever really got interested in the Beatles.
Phil.
Well, I wasn't so knocked out that I said, my God, they're doing something I'm not doing. It was just like everybody was doing basically what we had been doing. What had happened in the industry is that the industry had gotten into teenage idols. And we were not teenage idols. We were a duet, a very strange thing in this industry. But that's what created the void in the industry that allowed the British take the line that everybody had dropped here by getting into teenage idols kind of stuff and that teen screen, this, that, and the other kind of attitude about the music. They just picked up the music and brought it back over to us.
Toen in 1964 een ware golf van Britse bands met de Beatles voorop de Verenigde Staten aanvielen, waren Don en Phil in de frontlinie simpelweg zo'n beetje de eerste slachtoffers. Joe Smith.
I really believe that we can't underestimate the impact of that British invasion on bringing to a halt the success of the Everly Brothers. It pushed a lot of careers off the boards, but that was one sufficiently fragile at that time to just go under with the wave. The Beach Boys suffered a temporary setback, but they remained big. But there was no question that the playlists that were so full of the Searchers and every other group that came out of England was damaging to the chances of the Everly Brothers.
Yeah, it's so easy to find yourself out of step with the times, you know, because let's face it, that did just fall on its face about 1963, didn't it?
Na een hele serie slechtverkopende platen haalde Gone, 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 uitgebracht tegen het eind van 1964, een 31ste plaats in de Amerikaanse en een 30ste plaats in de Engelse hitparade. Engeland was sowieso vriendelijker voor de broers dan hun eigen land. Een vreemde zaak eigenlijk, omdat concurrentie uit Engeland hen belette een hogere plaats op de Amerikaanse hitparade te bereiken. Zowel de Ferris Wheel als That'll Be The Day waren kleinere hitjes in Engeland. Duren, zodat de Everly Brothers weer een beetje zouden doorbreken in Engeland. The Price of Love kwam de Engelse top 20 binnen, bereikte de 10e, de 5e en net niet de eerste plaats. Het bleef helemaal niet zo slecht hangen op een 2e plaats. Maar deze revival vond alleen in Engeland plaats. In Amerika maakte de plaat helemaal geen indruk. Phil Everly.
That's because the English people are more honest about their music than America. America, you can jive turkey them. If you make it in England, you have to be able to stand and deliver. I'm sure it happens once in a while, but not like it happened here. And I think that's the difference. So the people were saying, well, the music's right. You're doing it right again, and we'll buy it. That's what they said to us with Price of Love. America, they were still over here. They were buying the Beatles. You know, everybody was so Beatleized.
Wine is sweet and gin is bitter.
Brothers leefde door het Britse succes weer helemaal op en produceerde een succesvolle LP, In Our Image, en voor Engeland opnieuw een hitsingle. Was de laatste Engelse top 30 hit voor de Everly Brothers. De opvolger, The Power of Love, haalde het niet. De jongens waren zich bewust van het feit dat het noodzakelijk was hun repertoire te veranderen. En daarom waren ze rond deze tijd op zoek naar andere richtingen voor hun talent. Phil was bezig geweest met management, terwijl beide broers, en in het bijzonder Don, zich hadden bezig gehouden met hun eigen platenlabel, Calliope, Phil.
It's a name Donald thought up, and kind of, it was more his baby than mine. I was just sort of involved. And before we'd left Wesley, we had run across a song. Donald had found a song called Norman, which became a hit by Sue Thompson, but he wanted to cut it with Molly B at the time, and we had the song out here for about three or four months, and that sort of stymied when we left Wesley. That sort of broke that down, but that led us to looking around and saying, well, you know, we can pick... we brought Bob Luman to Nashville, too, as a country act. So we had done some of that finding things, and then Donald did a thing on Pomp and Circumstance, had an instrumental arrangement of it that was unique and got banned in England.
Done.
I started Calliope because I wanted to do something with horns and big bands, and I couldn't fit it into what the Everly Brothers were doing. By then, I did all the arrangements over the years, really. I got very involved in arrangements and was doing, I think, really, probably a little bit too progressive for the market we were dealing with, you know. But Calliope was so that I could do these big band things, and I did Pomp and Circumstance, which couldn't be released in England, strangely enough. But I made it to the top 20 with it here. It's a thing called, I did it under the name of Adrian Kimberly.
Joe Smith.
The Calliope label was there, and it was faltering and fading. They were impatient with it. They had an overhead, they had an office, they had to have a promotion man. They didn't have the time or the desire to make other records with other people. So as a result, the fellow who was running it was signing artists, and that wasn't their intent. They thought they could lay off some records on there, and it faded very quickly. I don't think they had a terribly strong commitment towards it. And if you talk with the boys, you'll probably find that's true.
Phil Effley.
It was a sort of experimental things. We had a guy working there, and we let him go. We wouldn't go to the office, you know. I went there one time, and you had to push the door. It was like all the mail had stacked up, and I just had to get my shoulder behind the door to get it open. So we didn't work real hard after that. Slipping and a sliding, peeping and a hiding, been told a long time ago. Slipping and a sliding, peeping and a hiding, been told a long time ago. I've been told, baby, you've been bold, gonna be a fool no more. Okay, conniver, nothing but a jiver, done got it to your jive. Okay, conniver, nothing but a jiver, done got it to your jive. Slipping and a sliding, creeping and a hiding, gonna be a fool no more. Mama Linda, she's a solid cinder, you know you better surrender. Oh, Mama Linda, she's a solid cinder, you know you better surrender. Slipping and a sliding, creeping and a hiding, gonna be a fool no more. Slipping and a sliding, creeping and a hiding, been going a long time ago. Slipping and a sliding,
thousand times. You're never home, never, never, never home. Every time I call your mother, give me the same old line. It's plain to see you're ducking me. Treatment from you. used to be as close as pages in a book. Baby, what's the score? Don't you love me anymore? We've been apart so long, I've forgotten how you look. I've missed you so.
Waren Don en Phil met Silent Treatment, een van een aantal onlangs uitgebrachte nummers die Warners in de archieven heeft gevonden. Misschien lijkt het nummer op zich een vreemde keus. Het is wel een aanwijzing voor de problemen die er nu voor de Everly Brothers bestonden. Joe Smith.
As the change came and this wave of English hit the States and our charts, they were casualties. And we went through a 3 or 4 year period of just awful searching, trying to rediscover an identity for themselves. They went through so many changes in their approach to repertoire. The music changed even more radically in the mid-60s with the hard rock bands.
Toch hadden de Everlys wat goede kaarten in handen. De jaren die ze tijdens hun jeugd voor de microfoon hadden doorgebracht en verder de talloze optredens in kleine stadjes die hen een enorme basis hadden gegeven. Als zingende act waren ze onberispelijk en bijna onverslaanbaar. Dus Don en Phil deden weer grote aantallen tournees.
Yeah, this was 63. The Odeon Hammersmith. Sunday, November the 3rd.
Don terugdenkend aan een optreden vanwege een oud aanplakbiljet.
But on the front cover of this, it says the Everly Brothers, Bo Diddley and Little Richard. Now, what a lineup. Really. That goes back to when 57 you used to see groups of old rock and roll stars together like that. Who else is on the bill? Of course, the Flintstones, Ray Cameron introduces Mickey Most, the Rolling Stones, oh, we know who they are, the Rattles, Julie Grant, Bo Diddley, Little Richard, and the Everly Brothers.
De promotor, die destijds verantwoordelijk was voor de tournee, is nu de manager van de Electric Light Orchestra en directeur van Jet Records. Zijn naam is Don Arden.
I'm Don Arden, and in 1963... as a British promoter, I first came into contact with the Everly Brothers. I promoted them on a pretty large-scale tour in England and Europe. In fact, I think we covered about 50 dates. I was attracted to the Everly Brothers because I always thought that they were an extremely talented act with an exceptional touch of class. And I thought that it was prestigious for a promoter to use them, and there's no doubt that their performance never ever sagged. They always gave their best, and they were a brilliant act.
Met de Italiaanse versie van So Sad besluiten we deel 4 van de Everly Brothers story. In Londen geproduceerd door Emison. Luister volgende week naar het 5e deel. Techniek vanavond Jack Hollemans. Poster is een trotsprogramma van Tom Mulder.
Buona fortuna amore mio. Buona fortuna ovunque andrai. Ricorda che